Om Namo Bhagavate Vasudevaya. Om Namo Bhagavate Vasudevaya. Om Namo Bhagavate Vasudevaya. Narayanam Namaskritya Naram Chaiva Narottamam Devim Sarasvatim Vyasam Tato Jayam Udirayet Nashtu Prayeshu Bhadreshu Nityam Bhagavat Sevaya Bhagavatyuttama Shloke Bhaktir Bhavati Neshtiki. So we are continuing the reading from Srimad Bhagavatam, 5th canto, entitled The Creative Impetus, chapter 11, entitled Jad Bharat Instructs King Rahugan, and text number 3. Please repeat after me. Na tasya tatva grahanaya sakshat variyasir api vachaha samasan swapne niruktya grihmedhi sokhyam na yasya heyanumitam Swayam Syat Natasya Tattva Grahanaya Sakshat Variyasira Pivachah Samasan Swapne Niruktya Grihmedhi Sokhyam Nayasya heya numitam swayam syat Natasya tattva grahanaya sakshat Variyasira pivachah samasan Swapne niruktya grihmedhi sokhyam Nayasya heya numitam swayam syat Natasya tattva grahanaya sakshat Variyasira pivachah samasan Swapne niruktya grihmedhi sokhyam Nayasya heya numitam swayam syat. Hare Krishna. Natasya tattva grahanaya sakshat. Variyasira pivachah samasan. Swapne niruktya grihmedhi sokhyam Natasya heyaha anumitam swayam syat Natasya tattva grahanaya sakshat Variyasira pivachah samasan Swapne niruktya grihmedhi sokhyam Nayasya taya numitam swayam syat Natasya tattva grahanaya sakshat Variyasira pivachah samasan Swapne niruktya grune di swapyam. Nayasya heya numitam swayam syat. Natasya tatva grahanaya sakshat. Variyasirapi vachaha samasan. Swapne niruktya grihamedhi sokhyam. Nayasya heya numitam swayam syat. Natasya tatva grahanaya sakshat. Variyasirapi vachaha samasan. Swapne niruktya grihamedhi sokhyam. Nayasya heya numitam swayam syat. Matajis. Natasya tatva grahanaya sakshat. Variyasirapi vachaha samasam. Swapne niruktya grihamedhi sokhyam. Nayasya heya numitam swayam syat. Natasya tatva grahanaya sakshat. Variyasirapi vachaha samasam. Swapne niruktya grihamedhi sokhyam. Nayasya heya numitam swayam syat. Word to word meaning, translation and purport by His Divine Grace Abhay Charanarvind Bhakti Vedanta Swami Srila Prabhupada. Srila Prabhupada ki jai. Please repeat after me. Na, not, tasya, of him, a student studying the Vedas, tatva grahanaya, for accepting the real purpose of Vedic knowledge, sakshat, directly, variyasihi, very exalted, api, although, vachaha, words of the Vedas, samasan, sufficiently became, swapne, in a dream, niruktya, by example, griha medhi sokhyam, happiness within this material world, na, not, yasya, of him who, he anumitam, concluded to be inferior, swayam, automatically, syat, become. Can anyone understand simply by word-to-word meaning what should be the translation of this verse? It's very difficult actually. Like, without Prabhupada's translation, as His Grace Bimal Krishna Prabhu mentioned other day, practically impossible for us to understand. Even if we know Sanskrit and we can understand the shloka, to understand the meaning is very difficult. Translation goes as follows. A dream becomes automatically known to a person as false and immaterial. And similarly, one eventually realizes that material happiness in this life or the next, on this planet or a higher planet, is insignificant. When one realizes this, the Vedas, although an excellent source, are insufficient to bring about direct knowledge of the truth. So perfectly Srila Prabhupada has translated this, if we see in the line of word-to-word meaning. So please repeat the translation after me. A dream becomes automatically known to a person as false and immaterial. And similarly, one eventually realizes that material happiness in this life or the next, on this planet or a higher planet, is insignificant. When one realizes this, the Vedas, although an excellent source, are insufficient to bring about direct knowledge of the truth. Swapne niruktya grihamedhi sokhyam. Niruktya means by example, swapne. So he is giving the example of a dream. Grihamedhi sokhyam, the happiness which is perceived in the material world. Jai Shri Shri Radha Madan Mohan Lalita Devi Vishakha Devi Sakhi Vrind Ki Jai Shri Shri Krishna Balram Bhagwan Ki Jai Patit Pavan Shri Shri Gauranitai Ki Jai Shri Prahladesha Nirsingh Dev Bhagwan Ki Jai Srila Prabhupada Ki Jai Swapne Niruktya Grihamedhi Sokhyam. So as we understand that a dream is not real automatically. When we wake up, we automatically understand that the dream was not real. Similarly, a person eventually realizes, Prabhupada said, eventually realizes that this material happiness is also not real. It is insignificant. And then what happens? Na yasya heya numitam swayam syat. Swayam syat means automatically. Like when we wake up from a dream, without anyone's telling us, we automatically understand that the dream was not reality. Does somebody need to tell us that what you were seeing in the dream, it was not reality? Automatically we understand. So similarly, this swayam sayat, it means automatically. So when a person engages in pursuit of material happiness, in due course of time, he automatically understands. Heya anumitam, heya means inferior. Prabhupada has said, concluded to be inferior. Anumitam means anuman, anumitam. He concludes that this is inferior. Na tasya tattva grahanaya sakshat variya sirapi vacha samasan. Then what happens? Then, na tasya tattva grahanaya sakshat. He understands that this Vedas, which is coming from the last few verses, that these Vedas are actually not sufficient for understanding the real truth. Like yesterday, His Grace Bimal Krishna Prabhu mentioned, there are Vedvadas, Tattvavada. So Vedvadis, they are limited to material happiness, pursuit of material happiness. But Tattvavadis are higher than them, and that is why the Tattvavadis will not get Tattva in the Vedas. Vari asir api vacha samasan, although they are an excellent source, vari asir, although the Vedas are considered to be an excellent source, but still they are insufficient. So this is the meaning of the verse. Now let us read Srila Prabhupada's purport. It is a little long purport, so I request your kind attention. In Bhagavad Gita, 2nd chapter, 25th verse, Krishna advised Arjun to become transcendental to the material activities impelled by the three modes of nature. Traigunya Vishaya Veda, Nis Traigunya Bhavarjuna. The purpose of Vedic study is to transcend the activities of the three modes of material nature. In the material world, the mode of goodness is accepted as the best, and one can be promoted to the higher planetary system by being on the Sattvaguna platform. So because it is a long purport, we may miss the points if we read the whole thing, so we'll try to cover as the points come. So here Krishna mentioned to Arjuna in Bhagavad Gita that he should transcend the three modes. Now what do Vedas talk about? The majority of the Vedic wisdom focuses on giving the right way of working to people who are engaged in material activities. People naturally have materialistic tendencies. The spirit soul has come down to this material world. For what reason? To enjoy, to pursue sense gratification. So this tendency is already there. Now people want to pursue sense gratification by doing materialistic activities. So Vedas, what they do is, they guide. Yesterday, like a very nice story was told in this regard, that a person was there, he wanted some material things. So if the sadhu would have directly told him higher subject matters, he would not have been able to accept that. So the Vedas, what they do, they tell, okay, you do that thing, but do it in this way. So that at least that person is following Shastra, and the Shastra will gradually lead him by this following eventually to the real truth. So this is a systematic process of bringing a person to the real truth, Tattva, as it is mentioned, Tattva Grahanaya. So Vedas actually are elaborately, they are most of the sections in the Vedas, they only mention how to do the materialistic activities in the proper way. This is what is mentioned. So that is why what is the purpose of telling all those things? The real purpose is not to keep that person engaged in those materialistic activities, rather the purpose is to take that person out of those materialistic activities, that gradually he will understand. Like eventually, he anumitam, it comes. Hey Anumitam, eventually by engaging in those kind of activities, he will understand that this is inferior actually. But in the now these materialistic activities, they are done under the three modes of material nature. In the 14th chapter of Bhagavad Gita, Krishna has very, very elaborately and very systematically explained how the living entity comes in contact with these three modes of material nature, what are the effects of the three modes of material nature, goodness, mode of goodness, mode of passion and mode of ignorance. What are the symptoms, how a person behaves in those modes and how a person can come out of those three modes and how a person who has already come out of these three modes, how he behaves. So all those things have been very nicely explained. Now among these three modes, the Vedas, the process, like the Vedas mention that okay, you follow the method given in the Shastra to pursue your materialistic activities. But the process, the basic process is to bring them to the mode of goodness. Like suppose somebody wants to enjoy in mode of ignorance, in mode of passion. So the Vedas prescribe some process of doing it, but the purpose behind that process is to gradually bring him to mode of goodness. And what can mode of goodness give at best? Urdhvam gacchanti sattvastha. Those who are situated in the mode of goodness, they go in the higher planetary system. So this is what Srila Prabhupada is mentioning. Of course, in the material world, the mode of goodness is accepted as the best. Among the three modes, this is the best. And one can be promoted to the higher planetary systems by being on the Sattvaguna platform. However, that is not perfection. This we have to understand. That this is not perfection. The real tattva is beyond this. One must come to the conclusion that even the Sattvaguna platform is also not good. Now, some of us may think that Sattvaguna platform is not good. That means Shuddha Sattva, Vasudev, Vishuddha Sattva is not good. Actually, here we have to understand that this Sattvaguna platform is not good. By saying this, Srila Prabhupada means that Sattvaguna, which is contaminated with little traces of mode of passion and mode of ignorance, this is Sattvaguna in the material world. How we find mode of goodness in the material world? It is not pure goodness. In the material world, mode of goodness is tinged with mode of passion and mode of ignorance. So this kind of Sattvaguna, Srila Prabhupada is saying, is also not good. One may dream that he has become a king with a good family, wife and children, but immediately at the end of that dream, he comes to the conclusion that it is false. So by coming in this material mode of goodness, one may be elevated to higher planets, heavenly planets, even up to Brahmaloka, but ultimately it is temporary and one has to come down again. Kshine punye punar mart lokam vishanti. So that is why it is just like a dream only, which although appears real when a person experiences it, but after it is over, a person gets to know that it was not temporary, it was not permanent, it is just temporary. So it is as good as a dream only. It may be a prolonged dream, it may be a shared dream, but ultimately it is a dream. Similarly, all kinds of material happiness are undesirable for a person who wants spiritual salvation. So a person who wants to be awake, for him dream is a waste of time. A person who has got so many engagements, who has basically got so many engagements, for him dreaming is a waste of time. Even if you offer him the best kind of dream, that this dream you will become a great king, you will have a very nice wife, nice children, good apartment, good job, good package, everything will be there, but will a intelligent person like to enter into that kind of a dream? No, because he knows that this is false. So So if a person who wants spiritual salvation, a person who wants to be awake, for him this dreaming is simply a waste of time. So similarly, a person who wants spiritual salvation, for him any kind of material happiness, be it elevation to higher planetary systems also, that is also waste of time, not useful. He is not interested. It is undesirable, Prabhupada is saying. Doesn't desire that. If a person does not come to the conclusion that he has nothing to do with any kind of material happiness, he cannot come to the platform of understanding the absolute truth or tattva jnana. So long as a person is enjoying in a dream, he wants to enjoy in a dream, he cannot come to the wakeful situation. A person has to realize that what I am experiencing now is just a temporary dream, it is just wasting my time, I should become awake and become engaged in my real occupation. So that is called tattva jnana. Then that person will become qualified to understand absolute truth. Karmis, jnanis and yogis are after some material elevation. So those who are for material elevation means they are pursuing dream or reality. They are pursuing dream, right? So Prabhupada has proved that karmis, jnanis and yogis, they are what? They are dreamers actually. These are very big words for us. We are so much attracted by karmis. Oh, he is such a sincere, such a hard-working person. Look, in such a short time, he has progressed so much, got a big job, got a very nice apartment, got so much promotion, he has got so many followers, he is so famous, he is doing so much for the country, he is such a big scientist. We are so fascinated by these things. He is such a big jnani, speaks so nicely, knows so many verses, so many things. But all these people are dreamers actually. Srila Prabhupada ki jai. Okay, how they are dreamers? This Srila Prabhupada is mentioning. Because they are after some material elevation. The karmis work hard day and night for some bodily comfort, and the jnanis simply speculate about how to get out of the entanglement of karma and merge into the Brahman effulgence. The yogis are very much addicted to the acquisition of material perfection and magical powers. But all these things are ultimately spiritual or material? Material. Temporary or permanent? Temporary. So that is why they are of the nature of dreams. All of them are trying to be materially perfect, but a devotee very easily comes to the platform of nirguna in devotional service. Is a devotee trying to become materially perfect? No, he wants to become nistraigunya, as Krishna is saying, nistraigunya bhavarjuna. So here Srila Prabhupada is telling how one can become nistraigunya. A devotee very easily comes to the platform of nirguna in devotional service, and consequently, for the devotee, the results of karma, jnana and yoga becomes insignificant. In the last sentence, Prabhupada was saying, the karmis work hard day and night. Just imagine, a person is working so hard. Don't we feel very sorry for him? He's working so hard. Suppose somebody tells us that a person is working very hard. But what he got? Like, suppose I work very hard, and after working very hard, I come to you, you are my master, and you tell me, you can see these notes? I say yes. And you say, take this. And I take that. Thank you very much. And it is not real. So after working so hard, if someone gets something which is not real, then imagine what kind of a sorry condition he is in. But devotee, Srila Prabhupada is mentioning, devotee very easily, we do not have to work. One thing is, we are getting the real thing. After working very hard, they are getting something not real. And devotees, very easily, what they are getting? Something real. What is that? Krishna Prem. Spiritual perfection. So this is the glory of devotional service. It is not an ordinary thing. And that is why, and when a person gets something real, does he give any value to something which is not real? He will not entertain it, right? So that is why for a devotee, the results of karma, jnana and yoga become very insignificant. He is not interested in that basically. Therefore, only a devotee is on the platform of tattva jnana. Which is the real purpose of the Vedas? It is there in the translation also. So I think in the first few lines of the purport it is there that this is the real purpose of Vedas, to give tattva jnana, not this jnana about how to do material activities properly. So of course the jnani's position is better than that of the karmi, but that position is also insufficient. The jnani may be better situated than a karmi, but still it is insufficient. The jnani must actually become liberated, and after liberation he may be situated in devotional service. Brahma bhuta prasanna atma na shochati na kangshati sama sarveshu bhuteshu mad bhakti labhate pram. So the perfection of jnana is bhakti. The perfection of karma is jnana. What is that? Jnane parisamapyate karmani akhilam jnane parisamapyate, something like this. In the third chapter of Bhagavad Gita, Krishna says that actually all the activities, they ultimately end in jnana, knowledge. Like, we can see this by example also. A person who is working very hard to get something, and when he works very hard to get that thing, is it very easily achieved? No, the material nature puts many, many impediments. We have, it is said in English, there is many a slip between cup and the lip. Although drinking something from the cup is very easy, we think. But in doing that simple thing also, there are so many impediments which are put forward by the material nature. And that simple thing also becomes very, very difficult to do. Right? So when one engages in karma, then one has to work very hard, and while working very hard, so many impediments are put forward by material nature. And after crossing through so many difficulties, he achieves something. But after achieving that, what he realizes? That is not also the ultimate. Because I was trying to achieve this for my sense gratification, but when I am gratifying, I am trying to gratify my senses with that, actually what conclusion I am coming into? That there is still more which needs to be achieved. This is not sufficient. When one gets one thing, he wants to go into another thing. Like a person who walks his way to the office. If he gets a bicycle, then he is very happy. After hard work, maybe he earns sufficient money to get a bicycle. Then after getting a bicycle, he sees that a person who is having a moped, he is overtaking him. So he becomes very, very perplexed. Oh, so much time is getting wasted. If I had a moped like that, then it would have been so nice. Then he works very hard, earns money, accumulates more money, works very hard to find out what is the right moped, invests his consciousness so much into finding it. And then he gets it. Then what happens? One day, a person with a superior bike, he goes in a very, very royal fashion and overtakes him. Then again he becomes perplexed. Oh, you know, this is also not good. There is something better than this. There is something faster. And so on. Like, you know, then he would see someone going in a car, then in a helicopter. There is no end to it actually. There is no satisfaction. So that is why all the karma, all the activities ultimately end in what? Jnana. Then a person realizes that actually so much hard work does not bring sense gratification. I am still not happy, despite working so hard, despite investing so much of my consciousness to enjoy the senses, still I am not happy. So this is the platform of jnana. Then what he wants? Then he wants mukti. A karmi wants bhukti, more and more bhoga, more and more things of enjoyment. But those things, one thing is, the goalpost keeps on changing. He gets one thing, he wants another thing, and also, in the process of trying to enjoy that thing, actually he suffers. Yehi samsparshaja bhoga dukh yone ayavate. Those things which promise us happiness by the contact of the senses, actually those very things are the breeding grounds of dukha. Dukh yone ayavate, certainly. All these things of enjoyment certainly bring miseries. So this is what is the situation of a karmi ultimate, and then he becomes a jnani. After many births in this way, he becomes a jnani, and then he realizes that, you know, I am interested in mukti because this bhukti gives a lot of trouble. I don't want to get into it, and I will not be happy, I will not be satisfied going in this path. So let me pursue the path of jnana. And he speculates, speculative knowledge and all these things he engages into. And what is his purpose? His ultimate purpose is to become free from the bondage of birth and death and become situated in a liberated situation. But he has no conception of the Supreme Personality of Godhead. He has no conception of his eternal occupational duty. He has no conception of his own swarupa, his own real position. So that is why he attains liberation ultimately after many, many births. Then what happens? Then still he is not satisfied. Either he falls down. Aruya krichrena param padam tato patanti adho anadrit yushmadangreya. Ye anne arvindaksh vimukt maninas tvai ast bhavad avishuddh buddhaya aruya krichrena param padam tato patanti adho anadrit yushmadangreya. Those people who follow other processes other than devotional service. They are vimukt maninas. They think that I am liberated. I am free from the cycle of birth and death, free from the bondage of birth and death. But what happens? Aruya krichrena param padam tato. They may reach the highest exalted position, but after that what happens? Patanti adho anadrit yushmadangriya. So what is the use of going to the highest story of the building when the next immediate destination is ground floor again? Jai Shri Shri Radha Madan Mohan Lalita Devi Vishakha Devi ki jai. Shri Shri Krishna Balram Bhagwan ki jai. Patit Pavan Shri Shri Gauranitai ki jai. Shri Prahlad Eshanir Singh Dev Bhagwan ki jai. Jagat Guru Srila Prabhupada ki jai. So after getting into the position, if the next destination is to come down again at ground zero, then what is the use of putting so much labor, installing big, big lifts and or going by the stairs and going all the way to the top, if we have to again come down eventually? So it is of no use. That is why they say they are called avishuddha buddhaya. Their intelligence is not yet purified. So they may reach the highest goal, but because they have neglected anadrit yushmadangriya, neglected the lotus feet of the Supreme Personality of Godhead, they have not accepted the divine, the most wonderful transcendental process of devotional service, they again fall down. So what happens? One who follows the process of karma, frustration, ultimately accepts jnana. And what happens one who follows the process of jnana? Again, fall down. Again, all the endeavor is wasted. That is why Prabhupada says in the last, Bahunam janmanam ante jnanvan mam prapadyate vasudeva sarvamiti sa mahatma sudurlava. This kind of a mahatma is very, very rare. Who is very rare? One who after many, many lives, after pursuing the process of jnana, forget about the process of karma, which is very, very inferior. After many, many lives of pursuing the process of jnana, which Srila Prabhupada says is better than the process of karma, but still what happens? Vasudeva sarvamiti sa mahatma sudurlava. That kind of a mahatma is very, very rare. So those who are following the process of devotional service, they must not be considered ordinary persons. All of you who are very, very fortunate, all of us who, by the mercy of pure devotees, by the devotees of ISKCON, we have got in contact with the glorious process of devotional service, which is attained after many, many births by even the most exalted sages, jnanis, and which is so pure and which is so special that it actually gives us the real benefit of the Vedas. What is the real benefit of the Vedas? What is the best benefit? Tattva jnana. It is mentioned here, this tattva grahanaya is not possible by the Vedas also, but by the mercy of pure devotees, we are so fortunate that we have come into the contact of this process of devotional service, and in that too, we are situated in the period of time when Sri Chaitanya Mahaprabhu himself, the Supreme Personality of Godhead himself, came down to inaugurate this most wonderful Sankirtana movement, Sankirtana process, which is very, very easily performed, suitable for the age of Kali Yuga. For us, reading the Vedic shlokas is very, very difficult. How many shlokas are there in the Vedas? You remember? How many? Ek Arab. it is close to 1 billion shlokas. And shlokas in Bhagavatam, we find them so difficult to understand. The Vedic shlokas are even more difficult to understand. Very, very difficult. So just imagine, for us it is not possible to read the Vedas, leave alone to practice them and understand the what the Vedas want us to say. So it was very, very difficult for us who are born in the fallen and degraded age of Kali Yuga. But Sri Chaitanya Mahaprabhu, by descending in this age of Kali Yuga, he has made this age the most glorious, better than Satyuga. In Kali Yuga, there's so many advantages, but so much can be said about that. But this Kali Yuga has become even better than Satyuga because Chaitanya Mahaprabhu appeared in this age. In Satyuga, if one performs mental offenses, he has to suffer. But Kali Yuga, we perform mental offenses, is no problem. Although we should not take it for granted. In Kali Yuga, even if we offer service by mind, then also we get the best benefit. But in Satyuga, by offering service by mind, one may not get that kind of benefit. In Satyuga, one has to live a very long life and wait to go back home, back to Godhead. But in Kali Yuga, the lifetime is very short. In this short lifetime, if we can practice Bhakti Yoga very, very sincerely, then in a very short time, one can go back home, back to Godhead. In Satyuga, people are very, very capable by their body, mind, intelligence, everything. So they may not be attracted to the simple process of chanting the holy name. They may like to perform austerities and penances and dhyana for thousands of years. Right? But we are so fallen that we cannot do those things. So naturally we have to go for bhakti, which is the highest process. So we are so fortunate. And that too, the holy name, Tatrarpita Niyamita Smaranena Kala, Chaitanya Mahaprabhu has made it very, very simple. But still we are so unfortunate. Durdevam Idrisham Ihajani Nanuraga. Because we are conditioned by these modes of material nature, Srila Prabhupada says that till the time a person is embodied, he cannot come out of the modes of material nature. Till the time we are within this material body, we will be conditioned by at least one mode of material nature. But those devotees who become Jivan Mukta, Ihar yasya harer dasya karmana manasagira nikhilasu piyavasthasu jivan mukta sauchyate. Those who are constantly engaged karmana manasagira by their activities, by their mind, by their words, in glorifying, in serving the Supreme Personality of Godhead, they can become free from the modes of material nature. Sagunan samatityatan brahma bhuyaya kalpate. So we should take full advantage of this wonderful process. Srila Prabhupada has preached the words of Sri Chaitanya Mahaprabhu, which were becoming lost in the course of time, Gauravani Pracharine, and we are so fortunate that we have come in contact with ISKCON and we are getting guidance of senior devotees here and we are able to practice the process of devotional service. So we should try to take full advantage of this and invest our consciousness fully in the process of Krishna consciousness, because that is wakeful stage. When we invest our consciousness in bodily activities, in sense gratification, then we are still under the modes of material nature, and that is dreaming stage. So no intelligent person will want to continue dreaming. An intelligent person wants to wake up. And what is wakeful state? Hare Krishna, Krishna Krishna, Hare Hare, Hare Rama, Rama Rama, Hare Hare. Being engaged in devotional service is wakeful state. So we should not waste. We should try to act in such a way that we do not waste even a single moment not being engaged in devotional service. All the time we should try to engage ourselves in different activities of devotional service, different limbs of devotion. And Srila Prabhupada has very, very mercifully given us so many programs and so many services, so many engagements, so that we can engage ourselves all the time in devotional service and we become eternally awake and go back home, back to Godhead. So I shall stop here. If there's any correction, comment, or question, then please, it is most welcome.
My question is related from Tattva Grahana. Tattva, real purpose of Vedic knowledge, but I want to know what is the actual meaning of tattva. Prabhupada is mentioning about Guru Tattva, Radha Tattva, or Shiva Tattva, or etc. So I want to know about Tattva Grahanaya, the real purpose of Vedic knowledge.
Yeah, thank you very much, Prabhu. Prabhuji knows, but for my purification, he's asking. So, Srila Prabhupada mentioned in the purport that if a person does not come to the conclusion that he has nothing to do with any kind of material happiness, he cannot come to the platform of understanding the absolute truth or Tattva Jnana. So, this Tattva Jnana is understanding the absolute truth. Vadanti tat tattva vidas tattvam yaj jnanam advayam brahmeti paramatmeti bhagavaneti shabdeti. So, this Tattva, absolute truth, is mentioned in Srimad Bhagavatam, and Srila Prabhupada has very nicely described it, that it is understood in three phases: Brahman, Paramatman and Bhagwan. And of these three phases, the understanding of Bhagwan, the Supreme Personality of Godhead, full of six opulences, is the highest. So this is Tattva. And this actually is the purpose of Vedas, as mentioned in Srimad Bhagavad Gita also. Vedeshu sarver aham eva vedyo. Krishna is saying, aham eva vedyo. The purpose of Vedas is to understand me. Vedant krit ved vedeva chaham. So this is Tattva. Thank you so much. Granthraj Srimad Bhagavatam ki jai. Jagat Guru Srila Prabhupada ki jai. Samved Gaur Bhakta Vrinda ki jai. Nitai Gaur Premanande Hari Harimu. Jagat Guru Srila Prabhupada ki jai.